Good afternoon. My name is Robin Jeffrey. I work in ISIS. It's my pleasure to be able to chair this afternoon's session and to welcome you, if you're not normally part of ISIS engagements, to this particular event. Today's event, or in fact, there are two events. There's Manjushree is also speaking this evening at the Arts House. She's in conversation with our colleague Ranajoy Roy, Ranajoy Sen, and with Mira Chan, the Singapore novelist. And that event is at 7:30 at the Arts House. What we have this afternoon is an installment in a semi-regular series that ISIS runs under the label of novel approaches to politics in South Asia. The founding of ISIS explains a little of this. ISIS was founded in 2005, partly as a think tank, but also as a research institute. And part of its brief is to disseminate knowledge of South Asia, the region, amongst civil society. Well, one way of doing that, of course, is to try to bring to attention of people who enjoy good writing and are interested in writers, to bring to their attention some of the interesting developments in the region we call South Asia, which is, of course, dominated by India, but includes Bangladesh, Pakistan. And today, of course, we get the opportunity to focus on Nepal, which is too often, I think, neglected. And we have the opportunity today to hear from somebody who is a Nepali, who's been writing about Nepal for more than 20 years in a very thoughtful and perceptive way. We play, I think, in some ways to the strength of ISIS with this particular series, in that Ranajoy has a particularly keen understanding of Indian and South Asian publishing, so he's able to identify rising writers, and I don't think it's inappropriate to say that Manjushree's career is going rapidly upward. There's a new novel going to the publisher at the end of this year. She's moved to a new publisher who will, I think, bring out her books even more attractively than they've been brought out hitherto. It's through Ranajoy's knowledge of the writing scene in South Asia that we've been able to invite Manjushree here. And it's an opportunity to learn about Nepal from someone with really very keen insights and a remarkable range of publications, particularly for someone who's not particularly venerable or aged, not nearly as venerable and aged as she should be, to have published as much as she has in such a short time and in so many genres. Manjushree was educated partly in Kathmandu, partly in the United States. She now lives part of the year in Toronto, and she comes to us today from 10 hectic days in Kathmandu. What's remarkable to me about her work is that she's written in all the genres you can think of. She has two novels to her credit, as well as books of short stories, political writing, travel writing, essays, and more than that, she's translated. We were talking at lunch. She was explaining that she lost her Nepali language as a kid. She'd learned Nepali as literally a mother tongue, then lost it during some education in the US, and then relearned Nepali, but has translated Nepali short fiction into English, which is, I think anyone who's done translation knows just how difficult that is. Her books, should you be interested after hearing her today, there are copies of her books at Books Actually in Chong Bahru. They went to some trouble to import a number of her titles, so you can read her work later if you haven't read it already. She's changing publishers at the moment from Penguin to a new house called Aleph, which produce beautiful books and market them, we hope, very aggressively and successfully. Today she's going to talk about being a writer in a small country in a time of tumult and change. And she'll speak for 35 or 40 minutes. Then there'll be time for questions, discussion if we wish it. And we'll finish, as is the ISIS custom, with a cup of tea and snacks around 4:45 or 5:00. So, Manjushree, please. Fiction at a Time of Revolution. Very nice title, too, I think.
Thank you, Professor Jeff. Thank you to you and Dr. Ranajoy Sen and to ISIS for having me here. It's a real pleasure. Is this well placed? Is this okay? So Nepal isn't one of the world's large countries. It's considerably dwarfed by its neighbors. And it doesn't get much attention globally, so it's always great to come to an event like this. Nepal's interaction with the rest of the world is actually very extensive. Migration became a very central part of Nepali identity after 1816, the War of the British, which started Gurkha recruitment. So, you know, there's a Gurkha presence in Britain, in India, in Singapore. The large Nepali population in Singapore attests to this. And especially over the last 20 years, as Nepal has opened and democratized and become part of the global economy, economic migration has become a real fact of Nepali life. So conservative estimates are that there are 3 to 4 million Nepalis in a country of about 27 million who are working abroad. And financially, they really keep the country afloat. It's become, to a very large extent, a remittance economy. So even though there are a lot of Nepalis all over the world now, and you can go almost anywhere and run into Nepalis, it doesn't have, Nepal as a nation doesn't have much of an impact in the world. It sort of goes through everything that it's going through in a very quiet way, very inward way. And it does everything that it's doing in relative obscurity. The writers of the country also write in relative obscurity. If you compare it to, you know, writers from India and Pakistan now, it's getting a lot of attention. There, we're waiting for the census data to really come out, but there are around 100 languages in Nepal. It's got a lot of diversity. Some of these languages are very well developed, have a large sort of written tradition. Some are really just have a lot of oral literature and aren't very well developed in terms of scripts or publishing. Nepali is the dominant language, and literature in Nepal has a very esteemed place. Writers are considered very much part of the intelligentsia. They're considered to have refined thoughts that they can, you know, then pronounce on matters of public interest. But literature itself isn't read very much. The publishing industry is fairly disorganized, and so just little things like distribution publishing are very disorganized. So the usual print run for a book might be 5,000 books in a country of 27 million, which is a mid-sized country. And the influence of Nepali as a language is limited outside of Nepal. So in India's northeast, you'll get the Nepali areas, and those are also very vibrant in terms of literary production, Darjeeling and Kalimpong and all that. And now there are a lot of Nepali expatriate organizations abroad which are helping to promote Nepali literature. But again, the sphere of influence is very limited. In terms of writing, you know, translation is something that worldwide, I think there's some really dismal statistic that 3% of the world's literature is translated into English. In Nepal, it's much, much worse than that because there isn't much translation happening. And English writing in Nepal is very rare. So it really only, because we were not colonized and we didn't have the English sort of education system that, for example, India has. And so it's really only in the new millennium that English writers have been fluent enough to come up and be published internationally, and I'm talking here only of literature. So it's really only after 2000, and even then it's been very little, until about a few years ago it was really just one other writer and me, which, you know, really doesn't end up being much of a literary scene. I mean, to have a really vibrant literary scene of the kind that you would have, let's say, in Delhi, you need, you know, schools of thought, styles, you know, arguments between them, you need rivalries, you need all of that. And even now in Nepal, there are maybe 4 or 5 English writers, and they're all friends, and we all get along, and it's hardly a scene, you know. So for me, even though I write in English, my community is really with the Nepali writers. I really consider myself part of that tradition and part of that community. I've written 3 books of fiction now, and they tend to involve, you know, have political themes or have politics with a big P or a small P in most of these books. And in a way, the subject of politics has really come to me just because it's sort of in the air that we breathe in Kathmandu, it's in the water that we drink, it's going through a very, very political time. I'm part of the 1990 generation in Nepal. You know, we've had a political movement for democracy for pretty much, it started right after World War I with the Gurkhas who fought in World War I, seeing the rest of the world and having this political awakening, coming back to Nepal and demanding changes there that coalesced into a democracy movement. So about 3 years after India gained its independence, Nepal had its first democratic movement and became a democratic country. It didn't last. 10 years later, in 1960, the king took over. It was always an autocratic system. The king took over and reinstituted the autocratic system. It took 30 years for us to get democracy back again in 1990. And you know, by that time, the demand for liberal and progressive values was so great that it almost became uncontainable. That after that, you know, 6 years in, we started a Maoist revolution or a Maoist war. The state responded very badly with a very sort of atrocity-ridden counterinsurgency. The royal family, which at this point had only constitutional powers, imploded with a sort of massacre at the palace that basically took out most of the royal family. And then the king who came in decided to take over in 2005 and reinstitute an absolute monarchy. So it's been a really turbulent period. It didn't succeed. In 2006, we had the third democracy movement. And in this one, you know, the Maoists were part of it, along with the democratic political parties. So since then, in 2008, we abolished the monarchy, which seemed to have consistently been holding the country back from democracy. And so since 2008, we've been in the process of trying to draft a new constitution, so far unsuccessfully. There's a very bitter struggle going on about whether this constitution is going to be more progressive in its leaning or more democratic and liberal in its leaning. So that issue hasn't been resolved. And so we're still, in a way, waiting for this revolution that started all those years ago to come to completion. Now, I'm part of the 1990 generation. I was just through with college in the United States when I was in Nepal at that time. And you know, Nepal rode this wave of democratization that went swept through Europe after the fall of the Soviet Union and the Berlin Wall. So suddenly, you know, this polity that had been closed, you know, I had grown up in a Nepal that where censorship was practiced very strongly. The sort of fabrication of national identity was very a very large national agenda. There were a lot of untruths and propaganda in, you know, our understanding of ourselves and of the state. And suddenly in 1990, Nepal had freedom, so everything, you know, it was a very optimistic time. It seemed like everything was going to change, and all of these rights, you know, we had always thought of ourselves as the subjects of our kings, and suddenly we were citizens. And so, you know, all of these universal rights that, you know, were available to citizens of, let's say, India, were going to be ours too. I voted for the first time in my life in 1991, and that experience, which you know, is the experience of, you know, exercising your freedom and your choice, really, it moved me very deeply, and it really changed me. And I think something really palpable happens in your understanding of yourself as a person when you become enfranchised, and so. It affected me so much so that I had actually thought that I was not going to live in Nepal. I was just in Nepal for a break between undergraduate and graduate studies, and I ended up living there pretty much for all of my adult life, except for the last couple of years. So it really sort of became part of my life to sort of be part of this changing society. There was a kind of optimism and innocence in 1990 that I think is very much part of my work. At that time, you know, none of us really realized that 1990 was the beginning of the process of democratization, and that there were going to be so many hurdles and so many setbacks and so many steps backwards, either because of the monarchy or because of the Maoist war or the counterinsurgency. We just didn't realize that there was going to be so much stalling and so much stagnation, because when you think of a revolution, you sort of think in terms of a big sweep of history, and it all feels like it's going to be very dramatic. And actually, so much of Nepali life is characterized by just waiting for some political movement, which is, you know, and something to happen. Like right now, we're waiting for the constitution to be made, and all of us are helpless. We're just waiting for it to be made. We didn't realize at that time that it was going to be like that. We thought it was going to be a much more sort of optimistic period of nation building, and we'd really get on with things, and the country would be prosperous. And of course, the Singapore model is something that, even though it's completely irrelevant to Nepal, it's much touted. So, you know, now more than 20 years back, when I look back at, I see that I've spent almost my entire adult life in a society in complete turmoil. A society that's constantly in the process of becoming democratic, but also in the process of unbecoming democratic and just falling apart. And, you know, all of the anxieties that accompany the process of becoming and unbecoming have been there, you know, the insecurities and the violence and the conflict and the constant renegotiation between people is part of Nepali life. So the hopes, you know, that were raised in 1990 just have been dashed again and again and raised again and again and dashed again and again. And it's just part of the cycle of life there now. So my writing really reflects this cycle of hope of, you know, of hope and despair, disillusionment. The first novel I wrote is the one that deals the most directly with politics. It's called The Tutor of History, and it's set at the time of a general election. I mentioned that I had, you know, voted for the first time in 1991. By the time I wrote this, I had observed two elections from fairly close up, and I had seen the kind of problems that elections in our part of the world have, which gerrymandering is very common to begin with, and then there's influence peddling and vote buying, booth capturing, vote rigging, intimidation, violence, you know, there's a lot of different forms of sort of skewing the elections. So this is some of the usual challenges that new and inexperienced democracies, and sometimes even old and experienced democracies, seem to face. So in the novel, I wanted to explore the issue of freedom and the limits on it politically as imposed by an election that's rigged. So the culmination point of the story takes place on voting day. And it's funny because after, when the book came out, it was 2001, and we haven't had elections since 1996, basically. And so by the time the book came out, it was already, you know, there was no longer any system of voting in Nepal. You know, everything had been reversed by the war or disabled by the war, the Maoist insurgency. So in 2008, when we had our most recent election, a friend in the UN said that he was reading the novel in order to try and find out what elections in Nepal used to be like, because there was no memory of it among the, you know, Nepal experts who come in and out and, you know, all of that. So he said he'd actually read like a bit of a manual on how to rig elections. So it wasn't really what I had set out to do, but it was something I was glad to be able to do, to be able to hold a mirror to the sort of failed politics of 1990, you know, a democracy that's flawed as we were practicing it then. So politics as a subject was very central in the novel, but it mattered to me only insofar as it had an impact on people. Of course, it's not just politics for the sake of politics. So I wanted to look at the issue of freedom also, not just in politics, but also in terms of people's personal lives. And, you know, in the people's lives take place, of course, in a very specific cultural context. And one thing that's made the transition to democracy really difficult in Nepal, and I believe this very strongly, is that the cultural values of Hinduism as practiced in Nepal are extremely hierarchical and is very, very comfortable with inequality. So the inequality between the genders, the inequality between the castes, between ethnic groups, people who are inside the caste system and outside the caste system, all of that, I believe, is a, you know, very anti-democratic values are at the core of Nepali culture as it had been set over the, you know, the period before 1990. And so, and, you know, Hinduism, only in 2006 did we become a secular country. Before that, we were, you know, very proud of the fact that we were the only Hindu kingdom in the world, and Hinduism was the official state language and something that was really supported by the state. And so I think that that's really held us back in a lot of ways. The protagonists of this novel end up, you know, living out their lives in that cultural milieu where inequality is just a part of life. And one protagonist, who's a widow, she lives in a very sort of circumscribed life of the Hindu widow. You know, you're not allowed to wear colorful clothes, you're not allowed to express desire, all kinds of pleasure are taboo, and sexual pleasure is particularly forbidden. And there's another protagonist who's a young and disillusioned communist who falls in love with her, and at that point when she falls in love with him too, she has to sort of see, you know, whether she can break out of this sort of the cultural dictates of Hinduism as set around her. So for me, the search for personal freedom in the novel is just as important as the search for political freedom. The limits on personal freedom through the culture are as sharp an affront as the limits to political freedom through rigged elections. Because fiction, you know, to write fiction is to be concerned overall with the individual, with the person, and not with ideas. I mean, I consider myself a writer of ideas. My work is led more by the themes that I'm interested in. So I'm interested in politics as a theme, but it only matters insofar as you can look at it through the lens of one particular individual that you're writing about. And this is, strangely, it's harder than it sounds, because what you write about becomes, or the person you write about becomes, a very difficult choice in the middle of a society that's in the middle of a revolution. I like to write about ordinary people, not about freedom fighters and heroes and people, you know, who are obviously the oppressors and the oppressed. And I'd really rather write about the anti-hero and the small person who's living out their small life than about someone who, you know, does something really brave and changes all of society. But when you're from a society like Nepal, which has the need for heroes and which is sort of a hunger for, has this hunger for big, you know, heroic figures, it's quite difficult to pay attention to ordinary people, and even more so to care about them enough to write about them. So, you know, how do you choose one particular ordinary person to write about when, you know, everyone, all these ordinary people are going through such difficulty, and then there are a few extraordinary people around? It becomes a real choice. Why not, you know, as bad as the widow that I wrote about, as bad as her situation is, there are always women who are in a much worse situation. Things like trafficking and, you know, all kinds of oppression take place. Other women have it much worse. Why am I not writing about them? Why do I want to write about this one particularly unremarkable person whose small act of defiance is very tiny? It doesn't change much. It just changes her life. So I have to overcome my own doubt about the value of ordinary people. You know, should I write about extraordinary heroes? Should I create the ideal rather than the normal, the real, you know? I also have to overcome the space given to writers from the third world. There's something that happens to people, writers like me, is we try, publishers and agents and everyone in the literary industry tries to channel you into writing about extremes, extreme forms of oppression, extreme suffering, extreme, you know, acts of drama or heroism or color or spice. So there's a very, very limited space to write just about ordinary people, people like you and me, the middle class, unremarkable person. There's very little space for that. People really want to hear, they want to see your protagonist suffer the absolute extremes that they could be suffering and overcome that in some heroic way. Something that, a kind of pigeonholing that the publishing industry likes to do. For me, it's really important to resist that, to establish the universality of humanity by writing about just very ordinary people. And so after I've made that, what is to me a fairly difficult choice, I have to remember that I can't just write about ordinary people. I have to do it in such a way that individuates that person and makes them very complicated, full of contradictions, and utterly human. You know, in this I've sort of pulled in pulled on two traditions. One is, as I said earlier, I really feel like I'm very much part of the literary tradition of Nepal, where political writing is fairly common. As in the rest of South Asia, Nepali writers are expected to speak on behalf of those who are voiceless. Some writers in Nepal speak up in a liberal tradition, and others speak up in a more progressive and even revolutionary tradition, sort of making a call for change. That's in their literature. Outside of their writing, also, writers are expected to be politically active. And it's been interesting, all three democracy movements in Nepal have had writers and artists, but particularly writers, at the forefront. And just in the last one, you know, in 2005, after the king took over for the last time, the poets of Nepal were the first people, you know, there was a ban on the right to assembly, as with a lot of other basic rights had been denied. So they were the first ones to challenge the ban on free assembly by holding public poetry readings. And every time they did a public poetry reading, the police would charge, and, you know, there would be sort of mayhem. And this image of the state attacking poets became so laughable that it made it made the state look so ridiculous that the state had to give up attacking the poets. You know, so once that stopped and the poets were able to start having public poetry readings, then other members of civil society joined in, and they became protests and became larger and larger gatherings. And so this very important right to assembly was brought back through writers. So that kind of direct action is also something that Nepali writers are expected to take part in, and also, you know, activism through their writing, through the content of what they're writing. They're expected to sort of use their voice towards moral and ethical ends, and to use literature to argue for reform and sometimes for revolution. So in Nepal, you know, there's been a very large growth in progressive writing in particular. And this is something that Nepal has, the influence has come in both from India and also from China. So social realist writers like Mahasika Devi, or the Chinese revolutionary writers like Lu Xun, have really had a big impact on Nepali literature from the progressive tradition. And I feel like I write very much from that tradition. But I also learned a really important lesson from the American literary canon, and I was schooled in America. In political literature, you often come across the problem of stereotyping and predictability. You know, there's the oppressor, there's the oppressed, there's a formula that the story follows to, you know, show the oppressed rising up and sort of overcoming their oppression. It can be rousing, this kind of literature, but it can also often read as very sort of formulaic and flat and mechanistic. And you see this a lot in political writing everywhere, not just in South Asia. You see it a lot in Latin America, you see it in Africa, you see it in places where there is a lot of political writing. The powerless Hindu widow is a stereotype that you come by often in South Asian writing and Nepali writing, which is exactly why I wanted to write about it. I wanted to take on exactly this problem of the stereotype in terms of how do you write about a South Asian widow who is experiencing all this oppression, but in a way that humanizes her completely. And that became very important to me, because in a sort of conservative culture such as Nepal's, individual subjectivity is always obscured by identities that are imposed on us externally. So I don't know the extent to which you can do this in Singapore, but in Nepal it's very easy when we just look at someone to place them socially. You can tell pretty much what their caste may be. You can approximate very closely their class, their caste, their identity group, their place in society. So there's a structure, a hierarchy, and you can kind of place that person exactly where they belong. And so some people are higher men, or higher caste people, or urban people are higher up in the hierarchy, and women, low caste, rural people are lower down. So we see each other already as stereotypes to a large extent. And so there's something very dehumanizing about this, where we look at the other as something very separate from the self. And fiction is precisely about undoing dehumanization. Political fiction, therefore, that depicts characters in a stereotypical way, even when it's very well meant, when it's calling for, you know, all of the ethically, you know, correct things that we want, even when it's well meant, it's very counterproductive, because it's repeating exactly the kind of stereotyping that society is already imposing. upon people. So when I wrote about this widow, I really wanted to humanize her, not just by giving her a sort of rich inner life, but by giving her hard edges and prickly bits and failure and ambivalence and contradiction. I wanted to make her sort of human, you know, just full of imperfect and human and uniquely her and not just any widow. And in this I was influenced by contemporary American literature. A lot of American literature, you know, I went to one of these creative writing programs in the United States where you spend a couple of years just learning how to write. And I found it very interesting because a lot of my American colleagues' response, I had started the Tutor of History by then, and a lot of their response to it was, is this a type or an individual? Because as soon as you say this woman is a Hindu widow, then you have to struggle against that stereotype to really humanize her. And so the challenge that they kept throwing to me was, is this a type or an individual? Is this one specific person you're writing about, or are you writing about a kind of person that exists in a Nepali society? Which was always a very difficult thing for me to answer. My question to my American colleagues, you know, there's such a focus on the inner life in a lot of American fiction, you would never know what else is going on in American society. You know, you're sort of seeing this person's life, you're seeing the conflict either with their family or their parents or their loved ones or their lover or whoever the central conflict is taking place with, and you don't see the larger society. So my question to them was always, what's happening around these characters? You know, so there, I mean, we all have issues with our parents or our lovers or all of that. We all have that. Isn't there anything else going on in their life? Is there a war going on in the background? Is there, you know, what else is America getting up to? You know, it felt very skewed to me. The ratio of the inner life to the outer life felt really skewed to me. And it felt a lot like navel gazing when you write endlessly about the inner life. As I struggled with this issue and the two traditions, it led me in a way to a meeting of Marx and Freud, or post-Marxianism and post-Freudianism, because it really became the issue that for me, I believe that people's characters are formed to a certain degree by the situation that they're in and the society around them, but they also have this freedom to act and to choose and to be a certain way, which comes from the American sort of intense focus on the psychological and, you know, the inner world. So I found that it was really important for me to find a meeting place between these two philosophies, these two political positions or stands, and as I worked on the novel, I came to seek out a balance between these two. This balance, I think, basically reaches us to the truth of fiction writing, because fiction writing, it is the task of fiction writing is to humanize. You humanize the characters that you write about, but you also humanize the reader, and obviously for the writer, you humanize yourself as you write, or remember that you are human. Fiction basically takes readers out of their own life and puts them into the lives of others who they might not necessarily be interested in. It's about engendering empathy for others that we're culturally trained not to think of as similar to us, either they're higher or lower or different than us, they're the other. It teaches us to blur the boundary between self and the other, and it makes us able to imagine the other and to identify with the other. So we begin to see ourselves as kindred spirits, and also we begin to see ourselves as equal and of equal value. This, I think, has far-reaching consequences in a society such as Nepal, where inequality is so much a part of the country. So if we're searching for democracy politically, but we're also searching for democratic values to come into our culture, I think fiction becomes a tool by which we are able to imagine each other's lives and to value each other's lives and to really see equality among us. So in that way, I think fiction, basically, the task of fiction is to change consciousness in terms of, you know, the consciousness of the individual reader and then the larger consciousness in terms of how people think about each other. And by shaping consciousness, it becomes part of this quest for democracy and it becomes part of the revolution. It's something that, you know, right now, particularly this is a bad time to talk about Nepal because we really don't know if we're going to get a new constitution and whether things are going to work out after all or not. And so sometimes people ask me, you know, do you have hope for the country? Are you feeling optimistic about it? It's a bad time to ask that. But the one thing I feel optimistic about and very sure about that I've seen from 1990 on is the change in people's consciousness. One thing that has absolutely, and I don't think it's reversible, that has changed is that Nepali subjectivity has become more equal now, and we relate to each other as equal citizens. And that the sense of that hierarchy and the inequality is eroding very, very fast. So that it, you know, just norms of behavior between, let's say, an urban, fairly well-to-do person and a rural poor person has, you know, it's becoming equal. So that kind of thing, the change of consciousness, I think, is absolutely there. It's happening very fast, and I don't think that's reversible. So I feel very optimistic about that. And for a writer, I think this is, you know, it's a real gift to be part of a society where people are seeking change and open to change and trying to reimagine their relationship with each other along more equal lines. So for me, as a writer, it's been a real gift to be part of the Nepali community, part of the Nepali literary community, to have so much to write about. It doesn't feel like it'll ever end in terms of the subjects. One thing that I think has changed is the optimism with which I started out my career in the 1990s writing has definitely ended. I mean, I feel very, a little bit tired because, you know, after all these years, we still don't have democracy. And we, you know, the struggle just seems like it's going to go on and on and on and on. It's taken up the lives of five generations at least before me. I know that the generation after me who weren't around for the 1990 democracy movement now are really facing this question of, you know, is their entire lifetime also going to be spent in a search for democracy? So it's a lot. It's a lot to be living with. It's an atmosphere that has a lot of sort of intellectual turmoil and intellectual hunger. There isn't the innocence, but I think that's okay. As a writer, you have to be realistic. And so I just feel very lucky that there's so much to write about. And the revolution in Nepal looks like it's just going to go on forever. One day it may end, but I certainly know that in terms of writing, there will always be so much to write about. So all of that. So that's my formal presentation. I'm happy to talk about anything else.
Manjushree, thank you. We normally we like to we like to clap in Singapore. In Australia, you don't clap. Thank you so much for that. That was a lovely, lucid presentation, it seemed to me, and throws open a whole lot of possibilities for conversation. Manjushree is happy to talk about writing, fiction writing, and about Nepal. So if you, yeah, please, go ahead. Maybe you'd say who you are, please.
Yeah, my name is Kuno Kikalami, and I'm a student at Hong Kong University. I also write fiction books for children in Hindi and English. I thought maybe you could, we were told that the population of Kathmandu has increased hugely because of the revolution, because a lot of people were brought in from rural areas, and so it's caused a lot of overcrowding in the city and so on. So I was wondering if you could speak somehow to this demographic change in the city, particularly in Kathmandu, and what it means really for this city, but also for political consciousness in rural areas.
It's Kathmandu sometimes feels really unrecognizable to me. When I was growing up in it in the 70s, it was really a small town. The generation before me, my parents' generation, my mom grew up in Kathmandu, my father's from the hills. My mother had to learn the local Newari language. The indigenous people of Kathmandu are the Newars, and they have their own language, which is a Tibetan-Burman language, quite different from the Nepali language. You could not live in Kathmandu without knowing the indigenous language. By the time I was growing up, that was already changing, and you know, there were enough migrants from outside of Kathmandu that settled there that you could just have a life in Nepali. By now, the indigenous people, Kathmandu is about 3 million people live in Kathmandu now. the war really drove people in just for security and also economic security because there's nothing else to invest in that was secure. So real estate, you know, there's this massive real estate boom, and everyone just has started to use Kathmandu as a platform also to go abroad then. So you come there, you consolidate your position there, and then you go abroad. So Kathmandu has become very unplanned, very big, very much a city of migrants. What's interesting about it for me is that the identity of the city has really changed from what I would have thought of as a Newari city to something that is a pan-Nepali city. So now it's really it's a city of migrants, and they've really taken it over, and it's, you know, established their presence there. So again, the rural has come into Kathmandu, and the gulf between the urban and rural has gone down because of that. There used to be, you know, the rural was really cut off and far away from Kathmandu earlier, and now everyone, you know, you can go into the rural areas. There will be, a lot of people will have some foothold in Kathmandu, and a lot of houses will have people working abroad. So both things have completely changed the political consciousness or the any kind of consciousness of the rural areas. People live much more of with a sense of Nepal as a global entity, Nepalis as with a global identity, as workers in the Middle East, for example, or workers in Malaysia, there are a lot of workers there, or migrants in the United States or elsewhere in the West. So Nepali identity, I think, has become very open-ended. It always was a bit open-ended with all of the Gorkha migration and the openness that, you know, there's a kind of porousness of the border in Nepal. So it always was a little bit open, but it's become even more open-ended now. So I think there's, again, it's the process of becoming. It's almost, you know, what was the Nepali identity has really eroded, and something is coming up, but I'm not sure if it's really, it's not stable, it's not defined, it's, you know, as the country changes and the economy changes and Nepali, you know, Nepalis move all over the world, Nepali subjectivity is also changing very, very fast. It's very, very liquid right now. It's,
Could I follow up on that? Because I forgot when I introduced you to say amongst the genre that you worked in, you've done a biography. And you did a biography called The Boy from Siklis. Now, why did you write a biography, and who was the boy from Siklis? Because that seems to be an identity question as well.
That book was a little, it was motivated a little bit by happenstance. There was a, early in my life, I worked in an NGO in the Annapurna area, a conservation NGO, and the man who set it up had been part of a very successful movement in Nepal for community forestry. With the help of Australia, they had, you know, instituted this policy, community forestry. It's one of the great successes of Nepal. And so he died in a helicopter crash, and a lot of environmentalists died in a helicopter crash. So because of my personal connection to him, I wrote a book. And, you know, Nepal, it's an under-narrated society, so I knew that if I didn't write it, it would just disappear, and everything disappears from public memory if you don't write it down. And so I felt very much like I really wanted to consolidate the information that we have about the kind of work he did in the Annapurna region and elsewhere in the field of conservation. So I did that. He's the boy from Siklis. Siklis is in the Gurung area of Nepal, which is also where a lot of the Gurkha recruits are from. So, and it's a very interesting area because that is one area where every single household, without exception, will have people abroad. So I know there's a large Gurung community in Singapore with the Singapore police. There's a lot of Gurungs in Britain, all over the, you know, United States. It's a very well-to-do community because of the worker recruitment. So he came from that milieu and was, in a way, very forward-thinking for his time in Nepal.
Thank you, Manjushree. My name is Iftikhar Chaudhary. I'm a fellow at ISAS. Excellent presentation. I just have a question with regard to people like you who sort of have been exposed to the outside world, write in English, and the indigenous Nepalese. I mean, would they respond to the same questions in the way that someone like you, who's seen the world, who can come back to Nepal and then look at Nepal, look at the milieu. I mean, so your writings would reflect the conflict with the global norms, etc. And you'll be more in a position to posit the global, I mean, the milieu vis-a-vis the individual. Whereas the indigenous Nepalese writer would perhaps tend to focus more on, you mentioned the comfort of these differentiations, I mean, being comfortable with the differences. So he or she would not, would focus on the individual, the family, etc., without the matrix. Is that a reasonable position to take with regard to this? Because normally we've seen those in the sort of the old British Empire, when you had this new wave of what we call the new Commonwealth literature, they came back home or they were very critical of things like the Housewarming Mr. Biswas or Wounded Civilization, etc. But not the indigenous of that. We've had many, I'm from Bangladesh actually. Recently we had a very famous Bengali novelist who passed on. All his writings there, he's written about 300 books and so, just focused on, as you said, the individual, the conflicts, the inner, this thing with the family, etc. But not on what was going on in the rest of Bangladesh, rest of the world. So would that be something that could be proven for?
There are two distinct traditions of writing in Nepal. One is the liberal tradition, and there are writers who focus very much on the inner life of, and the small life of, the individual. Right now, I would say the dominant school of writing in Nepal is the progressive school of writing, which also includes the sort of Maoist revolutionary literature, which has burgeoned in the past decade, which follows a very strong sort of propagandistic formula for, you know, what is written. Outside of the Maoist canon, the progressive writing that's coming out tends to have the kind of structural issues that I write about too. So we have both, and in that we're influenced very strongly by, you know, the Indian writers from the left have been a very large influence of all, in all of the different Bhasa literature, and also Chinese sort of social realist writing has been a very strong influence in Nepal. So we have both. It's not necessarily that because I'm from outside, and I actually felt when I came from outside, I was very illiterate about the intellectual life of the country, and it took me a long time to really understand what was being said in Nepali. Very sophisticated dialogues about aesthetics, about the ethics of different kinds of writing, particularly with postmodernism. The left has a very sort of robust dialogue going on with postmodern writing. So there was a very sophisticated intellectual milieu that I had to be able to get into through, by learning Nepali language and to become part of it. So I would say that was already there. The political writing was already there. And it wasn't something that someone from outside necessarily saw.
Professor Hassan.
Thank you very much. I'm Riyaz Hassan. I'm a colleague from my fellow at the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies. I wanted to be a writer, but I couldn't make it from becoming an academic, which means that I write but nobody reads it. I should say that very few people.
Your friend.
And the reviewer.
I have two questions. One is a puzzle that I've had for a long time. When I was in Singapore some years ago, the thing that surprised me, the Singapore leaders, and I say this without any criticism of anything, were more trusting of the Gorkhas than their own people. Really, there's the sense of loyalty. Is it something purely because they're paid to be loyal, or is it something of the Nepalese culture? Well, the second one is that given the extremely hierarchical subjectivities that you have just outlined, which are essentially grounded in Hinduism and the caste system, how do you deconstruct these subjectivities to get the very essence of this hierarchy as a writer?
The first question is interesting, the issue of loyalty, because of course we hear that a lot from the British too, and there's a sort of sentimental relationship with the Gurkhas because they've been such loyal soldiers. I don't think it's because people are paid. I think it is, there's something, Nepalis until very recently and even now come from a society where there's not a lot of justice. And so I think the experience of structure and justice where, you know, you're treated with respect and dignity and you do your job back and you're rewarded for your performance, I think that experience of justice is something that a lot of Nepalis respond to very well, because it's so rare in Nepal that you are able to really be part of a structure where you will be treated well if you do your job well. So I think it's something similar to that, where they're coming from a very powerless position into a place where they're given their dignity and their responsibilities and they're recognized when they do well. I think it's just that. I don't think Nepalis are innately more loyal or anything like that. I do think there's a real hunger for dignity. And so when they are given that, they respond very well to that. That's the only answer I can come up with. The other one about how do you deconstruct hierarchical subjectivity, it's, you know, the thing that makes us all human is this very stubborn kernel of desire that all of us have that just will not cooperate with us. You know, we need to do this or that to be good citizens or subjects or to be a member of this or that group or society, and our desire just will not cooperate with it. So I think it really is about, one of the things as a fiction writer that I find really important is to really live with my characters and to see where they are stubborn, where they are unhelpful, where they self-destruct, where they don't act in logical ways, and to find the movement of their desire. And that is really ultimately what makes us human and complicated and unique. So for me, it's important to deconstruct it to that level where, you know, you really see what desire this person is pursuing, even when it seems counterproductive or illogical or irrational. And that's the only way to sort of counterbalance this immense, you know, external identity that's imposed on us.
Hi, my name is Tang Li. I'm a blogger. I write a lot, but I don't get paid for it. The question I actually have to ask, because Nepal is geographically in between India and China, the traditional debate that a lot of Indians say is that China's achieved so much because you've got a communist government that eradicated a lot of things. How necessary do you think the Maoists are to Nepali society? And I ask that question because a lot of people have said the same thing about China, that Mao, for all that he did, was a very necessary force there, starting from ground zero again. And the follow-on to that would be, you've mentioned that the first political awakening came from Gurkha migrations. The irony here is that now the Maoists have announced that they want to stop all Gurkhas migrating. Would you see that this desire to stop the biggest group of Nepalis going out to overseas as a way of asserting control back onto gaining control of the political discourse?
I think, the Maoists are a very, very interesting and complicated force in Nepal. Those who oppose them say that, you know, it was 1990, we got democracy, 1996, the Maoist war started, basically took down whatever small, young, inexperienced democratic structure we had, completely disabled the state, really made us have to start all over again. So they see it as a very destructive force. I see that angle, and I think to a large degree they were, in terms of attacking grassroots democracy, they were fairly destructive. But I also think what they were able to do for their own interest and for their own desire to gain popularity and get to power is they were able to tap into this sort of hunger for justice that a lot of Nepalis have. And so, you know, ethnic groups who, you know, had been yearning for recognition, or women who, it's one of the a friend of mine calls it the Hindu Taliban. It's a very, very segregated society for women. So, you know, women who wanted to break that barrier and, you know, be as mobile as men. All of these groups, which would be the majority of the country, who had, you know, any kind of modernization had been delayed for so long. By the time it came in 1990, it was too little, too late, and so the Maoists were able to tap into that frustration. They did it, of course, in order to ride that wave into power, which they have done. On the other hand, they really genuinely have liberated people in terms of consciousness, in terms of attitudes, in terms of changing social relations. So how necessary were they? I think they wouldn't have been necessary if the democratic political parties had taken up this reform agenda with the same zeal. Unfortunately, in Nepal, the democratic political parties really are the main failure. They have failed to embrace democratic values and democratic norms. So, you know, they actively fought women's rights. They actively have fought, you know, now they're fighting federalism. The parties are very comfortable with Hindu high caste men being in charge of the country, and that's been their vision. So it's the Maoists were necessary only insofar as the democratic leaders really failed. I think happily for us, they didn't go for a year zero kind of strategy. They've been fairly flexible in terms of negotiating with the democratic powers, and now coming into this peace process where they've given up a lot of their own agenda in order to be part of the governing structure. In terms of their views on the Gorkhas, it's a sort of traditional nationalist view. I find Nepali nationalism very interesting and contradictory because we are such a, you know, blasted open society. I mean, you know, the economy wouldn't be able to float without all of these Nepalis working abroad and sending back their money. So in a way, and we've had an open border with India always, and if we had had a closed border, we would have had a revolution much earlier because not everyone would have left and the pressure would have built up inside the country much faster. So we've got this very open identity, and I think it's very troubling to nationalists, and there's always a real desire to cover that up with a very staunch sense of, you know, Nepali nationalism and autonomy and all of that. So I think the Maoists are responding to that and wanting, in a sort of unrealistic and nostalgic way, to pretend that Nepalis really are fully sovereign. And there's something a little bit not quite sovereign about Nepal as it is, and that's something that is very disturbing, I think, to the left and to nationalists in general.
Hi, I'm Rachel. I work at the FASS research cluster at the Cambridge campus. I research a lot on development in Nepal, and I'm interested in the connection between the internationally recognized literary scene and development. So since Nepal is such a development hub and has been for the past 40 plus years, to what extent could you say has this gestation, the small growth of an internationally recognized literary scene, can that be seen as one of the markers of development?
I would say that by development, if we're talking about the aid industry, which is my favorite term about it, because it is a very complicated industry and it's interacted with Nepal in very many levels, from, you know, the highest levels of government down to the grassroots. I would say that the aid industry has been very, very slow to read, recognize, and be part of the intellectual life of the nation. I think that it's really tried to be apolitical in ways that obviously are political. So by not being part of the intellectual life, I mean, there's been almost zero help to the literary community through aid. There's been a little bit of street theater, but, you know, that has taken down the standard of street theater, because when you get, you know, the street theater people preaching, you know, don't smoke, don't drink, whatever, social reform messages, that's the end of art. They've done the same for, you know, community radio is big in Nepal, but a lot of it is sustained by aid, just sort of trying to get its message out and paying the community stations to, you know, FM stations to broadcast their message. So I think the aid has been really problematic in terms of the relationship of aid to the nation's intellectual life, has been deeply problematic, very conservative, very unconcerned with the intellectual life of the country, I don't see that there's any relationship between it. I think the intellectual life of the nation has taken place despite aid and completely outside of the sphere of aid.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Keshav. I'm working at the LBY school. I'll just like to ask, because you have identified two main sort of challenges. One, I believe, is the lack of democratization, and the other one is the caste system, the social hierarchy. And I find it interesting, as in, you have attributed part of the progressive change, at least a little bit, to the Maoist movement in the absence of any other structure. So I was just wondering, this could be a little naive, but do you see any scope for literature as a sort of an active agent in, you know, because in terms of sort of breaking the social barriers or encouraging democracy, especially, you know, since Nepal is going through this whole transition, is there a place for it, or has there ever been a place for it? Literature.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a very important part of it, because it is about offering people's sense of themselves and sense of each other. So, literature that I think, you know, some of my favorite works of Nepali literature are those that really take us into the experience of someone we would never meet in our own lives. Let's say if you're a Kathmandu urban person. And you're reading this novel of a garawala, you know, who someone who operates a cart in Nepalganj, which is in the far west of Nepal. And you're thoroughly immersed in that story and really care about that person's struggle. Then it completely takes you out of your life, and you see that person very much as yourself. You identify with them, and I think that is where democratic values and equality and, you know, affinity, kinship, empathy, all of that comes in. Where social relations change is when we start to care about the other and not just about our own clan, our own caste, our own group, our small friends, which is really the prevalent norm in Nepal right now. So I think, yeah, fiction has a very, very, and literature in general has a very large role to play in terms of changing the imagination.
Manjushree, you translated some short Nepali fiction. How did you choose the pieces you translated, and what can you tell us about the authors you chose and their quality of writing?
I chose the pieces. I wanted to educate myself on Nepali literature, so I was doing a lot of reading of contemporary literature by my peers and my elders. And so for me, I chose the pieces as I got to know those writers and their works. And, you know, Kathmandu has a very, very active literary scene. It's huge. There are many book launches every day. It's, you know, poetry readings. It's hectic. You could spend your entire time just doing literary activities and not reading or writing. For me, it was a way to engage in Nepali literature. I was educating myself about who writes what, who belongs to what school of thought, what kind of aesthetics are in play. And as I did that, I chose representative samples of their work and translated them. There are these two basic schools. There's the liberal school of writing, and then there's the progressive school of writing, and now added to that has been the Maoist sort of canon. And for me, I just chose the pieces that I felt represented those writers the best and also spoke to Nepali issues the most powerfully for me.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Faris from the Institute of Policy Studies. You talked just now about humanizing your characters, you know, the need for humanizing your characters. Could you just expand on what you mean by that, the humanizing part, and to which point or to what extent do you feel that your characters are humanized? Because, you know, in a way that, you know, there's a possibility, or I think in a negative way, there's a negative possibility of you, you know, and reinforcing that stereotype, you know, within your characters when you humanize them, you know, in probably in an exaggerating way.
Right, yeah. I mean, I write in the realist tradition, so for me it's important to not caricature people, not caricature the characters. So even if there's a good person, let's say the hero, the anti-hero of the story was the main person that, you know, I identify with and the reader is meant to identify with. I think showing them as all good, all bad, all anything becomes oversimplifying. So by humanize, I guess I mean really making that person have the little sort of difficult angles that all people have, you know, and to show them as that particular unique individual. I try not to exaggerate any characteristics because then you're getting into idealizations of people and not staying with the realist tradition. So for me, realism is something that I try to cling to very closely.
What in your view makes a novel political? Or is it just talk about power all the time, especially because you talk about ordinary people who I imagine may not always be thinking or living out their lives in terms of power? Second, what makes a political novel excellent? I'm thinking of the biography of Marcus, 100 Years of Solitude. It was said that while Bill Clinton was reading that novel, it was also being read by the street vendor and the taxi driver in Bogota. So while he was writing about a small village in Colombia, it also was read, you know, all around the world. So are there very specific things that make a novel political and also excellent and political?
I think everything is political. So I think even when a novel claims not to be political, like the American literature I was talking about earlier, which, you know, there will be never a mention of, you know, the Iraq War or involvement in Afghanistan, whatever. None of that will ever come up. It's deeply interior, just looks at one family, one couple. I think that's a political act. To actively cut out society is a political act. So I think there's always an implied politics in everything. And, you know, having politics with a big P in the story is not necessary for a work to be political. I think the ethics of writing of each piece are within that piece itself. So when you read, I mean, since you took Marquez's writing as an example, when you read that and you enter that world, you're not necessarily learning about politics at all, but it's political because you then empathize with these characters, you become part of their world, you know, go outside of your life and develop an affinity and kinship. And I think that, again, is a very deeply political act. So again, I don't think it needs to have politics in the storyline or in any obvious way. I think everything is political. What makes it excellent, I find this interesting because also related to what, Robin, you were asking about, you know, how did I select these particular pieces to translate? I think at a certain time, in a certain milieu, certain works really resonate. They're very situated. They find there's a kind of truth that they speak to, where, you know, the audience who listens to it sort of recognizes that truth. It just has this, it's like a bell resonating. So I think for me, what makes a piece excellent is not necessarily that it's really well crafted. I think you can have fairly roughly crafted books that really strike a nerve, and that is where its excellence comes in. So it can be a very uneven novel, but it just speaks the truth of a society. Someone like, one of my absolute favorite writers is Mahasweta Devi, who writes both very politically in terms of the themes she's writing about. She writes about Adivasis in India or in West Bengal, and she's writing a lot in the background, the Maoist, you know, insurgency there. So she's got the politics, but they resonate not because of that. They resonate because the characters she's made and the stories she's made are so subtle and quiet and so such sort of loving portraits of people's lives that they just have this power. Yeah, and that's what makes it excellent, is not necessarily that she's taken up a big theme.
Mamta, we might give you the last one and then we'll be two.
I'm Manjushree Mamta from ISAF. I'm just wondering, why explore creative writing outside Nepal, and how important do you think this journey that you took beyond the country is in your writing? how has it enabled you any differently than if you didn't go outside the country?
I think for me, particularly as a woman, the amount of mobility and freedom I got from leaving Nepal, I don't see that I would have got that if I'd stayed there. I'm from a fairly privileged background in the Nepali context, and even in that highly educated, privileged sort of milieu, there's such a strong dictate for what women can and can't do, should and shouldn't do. I think that would have worn me down. So for me, I was completely formed by leaving, and by finding my freedom, the freedom to really break, and I went out of my way to break everything that was Nepali about me. I just got rid of it all, and then later, as an adult, brought it back as I needed it. So the mobility, just in terms of physical mobility, what I can do, where, eat, say, all of that, but also in terms of consciousness and what I can read and what I can express, that came to me only, I think, because I left and I was able to leave. There are a few women in Nepal who do that and don't leave. I know that I wouldn't have had that strength. So there are women who do that from within Nepal. And writers who do, men also who do that from within the heart. In terms of learning creative writing, it's just a bigger pool. One of the writers who has influenced me most deeply is Virginia Woolf. I think it's really important for me to read as much and as widely as you possibly can. So I think it is really important to get out of your own small milieu. I mean, Nepali literature has only been around for about 100 years in the written form, modern Nepali literature. So that's a very small canon to draw from. So I think it's very enriching for writers to just read absolutely everything that they can.
Manjushree, thank you. We'll stop there, but stop only in the formal sense. There's tea and snacks outside when we're finished. But thank you so much for a wonderfully lucid, clear, and just enjoyable to listen to presentation. It was wonderful. If you enjoyed it as much as I did, she's speaking again tonight in a slightly different format with Ranajoy and Mira Cham at the Arts House at 7:30. Meanwhile, before we close, we have the ISIS ritual of a presentation of our fine ISIS publication. And Yusuf will take a photograph. Thank you all very much.